Hello everyone, I'm Ankit Kirk. I'm a researcher at Microsoft Research India, and I'm going to be talking about learning arithmetic circuits in the average case via lower bounds. This is joint work with Neeraj Kayal, who is also a researcher at Microsoft Research India, and Chandan Saha, who is a faculty member at Indian Institute of Science. So arithmetic circuits, they are a very natural model for computing polynomials. You might have already seen them. So they look like something like the figure on the right hand side. So basically at the bottom level, they are either variables or constants from an underlying field. And then there are various gates, in this case addition and multiplication gates. And then you naturally compute the polynomial at the output gate, right? For example, this circuit is computing the polynomial x1 plus x2 times x2 plus 1. So there are three natural questions that are studied a lot about arithmetic circuits. The first one is about lower bounds. So here you want to find an explicit polynomial P which is not computable by any small circuit. Then there is polynomial identity testing, or PIT, where you're given a circuit either as a black box or explicitly, and you want to test whether that circuit computes the zero polynomial or something non-trivial. And finally, there's the problem of learning arithmetic circuits, or reconstruction, where you're given a polynomial P, either as a black box or explicitly, and you want to find the smallest circuit computing it. So these are three main problems about arithmetic circuits, and there are several connections known between these three problems. Okay? The connections between lower bounds and PIT, for example, the hardness randomness trade-off in the arithmetic circuit world. There are also connections between lower bounds and learning, and so on. So what we discover is a new meta connection. So yeah, what we discover is a new meta connection between lower bounds and average case learning. Okay. So if you have lower bounds for a circuit class C, this allows you to design average case learning algorithms for the circuit class C. Okay. And so yeah, what do we mean by average case? So by average case, I mean that the algorithms should handle most reasonable distributions on the inputs. Okay. So we'll see what this means. So basically the algorithms should work on certain non-degenerate inputs. And the set of degenerate inputs should form a variety, a low dimensional variety. Okay? So that if you pick the inputs from any reasonable full dimensional distribution, then with high probability you will miss this variety, or in other words, with high probability the inputs will be non-degenerate. Okay? Yeah, sure. So I should emphasize that this is the meta connection. So a lot of technical work is still needed to carry out this for various circuit classes, okay, and we'll carry out this for a specific circuit class. So to motivate average case learning, worst case learning is quite hard. So for example, for depth 3 set multilinear circuits, the problem of learning or reconstruction is the same as tensor decomposition, and which is NP hard, okay, due to a result by Hostal. And there are other hardness results about worst case learning of arithmetic circuits as well. Okay. So the problem is quite hard in the worst case. So we need to make some assumptions to design meaningful algorithms. There's an excellent literature which concerns designing algorithms in the worst case, but which are parameterized by some parameter of the circuit. For example, the top fanning of the circuit or something. So these algorithms have exponential dependence on the top fanning or something like that. Okay. So yeah, this is an excellent line of literature, but it's sort of disjoint from our work, so I'm not going to survey it here. Okay. So yeah, the way we will get around the NP hardness is by assuming some non-degeneracy conditions on the inputs. Okay, so let me give an example of such an average case learning algorithm. So let's consider the case of symmetric tensor decomposition. Let's say it's degree 3 here, which is the same as basically writing a degree 3 polynomial P as sums of cubes of linear forms. Okay. So yeah, it's NP-hard in the worst case. That is given a polynomial P. If you want to find the minimum number of cubes of linear forms that you can write it as a sum of, then it's NP-hard. But still, you can design meaningful algorithms for this problem. So for example, suppose the number of summands is at most n. N is the number of variables of the polynomial P. And the linear forms L1 to LS are linearly independent. Okay? Then given P, which is a sum of cubes of these linear forms, we can recover the LIs in polynomial time. So this is an algorithm to do generics, and it's widely used in machine learning. So two things to note about this is that we assumed a non-degeneracy condition on the inputs. The LIs are linearly independent, which will be satisfied if we choose LIs to be random according to any reasonable distribution. And also the number of summands is roughly equal to the best known lower bound, which is roughly n for this model, sums of cubes of linear forms. Okay? So this is in general going to be true for our results also. Our algorithms will hold under some non-degeneracy condition, and the number of summands will be roughly equal to the best known lower bound. Okay. So yeah, so now you can state our main result. So informally stated, we design efficient algorithms for the following model, where you want to write a polynomial P as sums of powers of low degree polynomials. Okay, so you want to write P as sums of sum of I qi to the power e, where degree of qi is t, which is much smaller than e. Okay, so you should think of the degree as being constant. So first of all, this is a generalization of symmetric tensor decomposition, which was writing a polynomial as sums of powers of linear forms. This allows sums of powers of low degree polynomials. So even the t equals 2 case, that is sums of powers of quadratics, is relevant for the problem of mixtures of Gaussians, and we'll see this connection later in the talk. And I should also say that substantially new techniques are required for t greater than equal to 2 case compared to t equals 1 case. Okay? And we'll also see why this is the case. Because the lower bounds problems corresponding to this learning problems also require very different techniques to solve. Okay, so formally stated, there's a randomized polytime algorithm that, given black box access to a polynomial P, which can be written as sums of powers of S, sums of sum over I qi to the E, recovers this qi's. Okay, so yeah, all polynomials in this talk will be homogeneous. So yeah, so there are some technical assumptions. So first one, of course, which I already said, the QIs need to be non-degenerate. So yeah, I will come to this non-degeneracy condition later, but this condition is satisfied if each coefficient, for example, is chosen randomly from a large set. Yeah, so then you should think of T as constant, field size large enough. There's some technical condition relating number of variables n and the degree d. So yeah, degree d in this case is just the degree of p, which is t times a. And also there's some upper bound on the number of summands which we can recover, and this is basically comes from what low bounds we can prove for this model. So basically, yeah, you should think of the degree d as being small, so roughly we can handle n to the d over some constant number of sum. Okay. Okay, so yeah, so let's now see how usually people prove lower bounds in the arithmetic circuit world. Okay. So yeah, we have a circuit class C. We want to prove lower bounds for it. So first we'll reduce to a problem of the following kind. So you want to write so yeah, you want to prove a lower bound for the following problem, where you want to write a polynomial P as sums of simple polynomials. Okay? So we'll see what the simple is. And you want a lower bound on the number of summands S that you need to write this polynomial P as a sum. Okay? So this is usually done by either a depth reduction, Or your circuit class C could have the following structure, where at the top there's a plus gate, and then you see that the children of this plus gate, you could think of them as TIs, which are simpler than the whole circuit class in some sense. Right? So either depth reduction or your circuit itself could have this structure. Yeah, so the second step is to identify special properties of this simple polynomials. Okay? So this is usually of the following kind. So you design a set of linear maps which map polynomials to some vector space W, and this set of linear maps are the following property, that is, they map the simple polynomials to a low dimensional space. Okay, so dimension of the space spanned by applying the linear maps in L to a simple polynomial TI, this dimension is at most little r, and the dimension when you apply it on your polynomial P, which you're trying to prove a lower bound for, is at least capital R. Okay. So if this is the case, then if P is a sum of T1 to TS, then the space spanned by applying this linear maps on P is a subspace of what you get by applying this linear maps on these simples, right? And by just linearity, the dimension of the space of L of P will then be at most the sum of the dimensions of the TIs. And since we have this constraints on the dimensions of the simples and P, we get that the number of summands S is at least capital R by little r. Yeah, so this is the high level strategy used to obtain lower bounds. And yeah, so let's look at an example. So we have this case of sums of cubes of linear forms. So in this case, the linear maps L will be partial derivatives with respect to the variables x1 to xn. Okay. So yeah, these are maps which map degree 3 polynomials to degree 2 polynomials. And you can see that when you apply these maps to a cube of a linear form, then the dimension you get is at most 1, right? Because you'll just get the square of the linear form up to some constant out if you apply any partial derivative. And also, if you look at the polynomial x1 cube plus xn cube, the dimension of the partial derivative space here is n, right? Because when you apply the partial derivatives, you'll get the polynomials x1 square, x2 square, and so on, which are all linearly independent. So in this case, for this polynomial x1 cube plus xn cube, the number of summands that you require is at least n. It's a very simple example showing this way of applying lower bound. Okay, so let's now see our meta learning framework. So the starting point of the meta learning framework is the tight lower bound method for the circuit class. Okay? So what do I mean? So if P can be written as a sum of simples T1 to TS, then we saw that when you apply a set of linear maps on P, then the space spanned by L of P is a subspace of the space spanned by the simples. Right? So what we need for the meta learning framework to work is that the set of linear maps L should satisfy that when you choose the TIs at random, then we'll get that the space spanned by L of P is equal to a direct sum of the spaces spanned by each of the simples. So what this means is that if one is able to perform a tight analysis of the dimensions of this L of P and the spaces spanned by the simples, then we can actually prove a tight lower bound for writing P as a sum of the simples. Right? So this is a starting point. So of course, only some lower bound methods will have this property, but we'll see that we will design some lower bound methods which do have this property. And we also further assume that the set of linear maps L naturally decompose as a composition of two sets of linear maps, each of them which again have this property of proving a tight Lorentz one. So one example is that the space of partial derivatives of order k decomposes as partial derivatives of order k minus 1 composed with partial derivatives of order 1. So now we have this P, which is T, sum of the TIs. We apply L1, the set of linear maps. Then we'll get the space L1 of P, and which can be written as by assumption as direct sum of the spaces corresponding to TIs. And then we again apply L2, we get L2 of L1 composed applied to P, which can be written as the corresponding spaces for the simples, the direct sum. So we have the structure, and we have access to P, and also hence the spaces L1 of P or L2 composed with L1 of P. So, and what we want to find is the TIs. So this motivates the following. So let me give an example first. So we have, consider the model of sums of cubes of linear forms. So in this case, we can apply partial derivatives of order 1 first. So you get the space U, which is the space of partial derivatives of order P, order 1 of P. And so if the LIs are linearly independent, this can be, this is equal to the direct sum of the space, one-dimensional spaces spanned by each of the LI squares. Okay, so this is something you can verify. Again, we can apply partial derivatives of order 1. We'll get V, which is the space of partial derivatives of order 2 of P. And this will be equal to the direct sum of the one-dimensional spaces spanned by the LIs. Okay? Again, if the LIs are linearly independent. So what we have is the vector space U. That is, we're given a basis of the vector space U and also a basis of vector space V. And we also have this set of linear maps, partial derivatives within U and V. Okay. So yeah, I leave it as an exercise to recover the LIs given the structure, this partial maps between U and V and a basis of U and a basis of V. Okay. So essentially you can see that basically it's trying to solve some kind of eigenvector problem, just that the spaces are of different dimensions and so on, but yeah, that can be fixed by some simple tricks. Okay. So if you carry this out, basically you'll recover Yannick's algorithm, something very close to it. Yeah, so to carry out this in general, this motivates the following problem, which we'll call vector space decomposition. Okay. So here we're given a vector space U, which is a direct sum of vector spaces UIs, and a vector space V, which is a direct sum of vector spaces VIs, and also a set of linear maps L between U and V. So the problem is, given this set of linear maps L between U and V, we want to decompose U as sums of UIs and sums of VIs, such that these linear maps map each component UI into VI. Okay? So L of UI is mapped into VI for all I. Okay? And further, you can also require that UI and VI are further decomposable into substructures. So yeah, this is the problem. And so believe it or not, there is a polynomial time algorithm for this problem in the worst case. Okay? So for all inputs, we can find such decompositions. Okay? This is the two gist of Karpinski and Ivanovich. So yeah, actually the algorithm is about a related problem called modal decomposition, and there is a simple reduction from vector space decomposition to this other problem. Okay? And actually, there's also a theorem called Kruschmidt theorem, which characterizes all such decompositions. Okay? So there's some non-trivial relation between all such decompositions. For example, the number of summands S among all such finest decompositions is the same. So then to apply this framework, then the main technical work to get learning algorithms is to, you want to prove the direct sum property, right? That is basically the tight Lorentz bond property that I mentioned, and also uniqueness of decomposition, right? we want to say that the decompositions corresponding with simples is only decomposition, right? And once we have that, then from there on we can recover the simples by some additional tricks. Okay, yeah, so this was the framework. I'm sorry if this was a bit rushed. You can always write to us or read the paper to know more details. So let me briefly mention this potential application to mixture of Gaussians. So the mixture of Gaussians problem you might have seen, you're given a distribution D, which is a mixture of Gaussians, and you want to find the individual components. Lots of applications across various scientific areas and lots of algorithmic work has been done on this problem. So usually in terms of designing algorithms with theoretical guarantees, the three kinds of assumptions people make on the input. So one is worst case, don't want to assume anything about the input parameters. So in this case, there are many excellent algorithms, but usually the dependence on the number of components is exponential. To get around this, people also make some separation assumptions on the input. For example, they assume the means are separated by some amount, something like that. So this is one class of algorithms. The other class of assumptions you can make so that you get an polynomial dependence on the number of components is the setting of smoothed analysis, right? Where you assume that the parameters are chosen initially worst case and then perturbed by some amount so that they are not completely worst case. Okay? And yeah, so our result is most relevant to the study of smoothed analysis of mixtures of Gaussians. Okay? So in this case, we know polytime algorithms for the case when the number of components is at most poly n, and here is the dimension of the Gaussians, and also when the covariance matrices are diagonal. Okay? So basically, X is aligned Gaussians. And for general Gaussians, when we have general covariance matrices, we have polytime algorithms only when the number of components is bounded by square root of the dimension. And okay, so yeah, one thing I should mention is an interesting thing that happens here is the blessing of dimensionality. So here we can handle more components when the dimension is higher. The reason is that when you have higher dimension, then lower order movements already give you a lot of information about the data. Okay? And lower order movements are easier to estimate than higher order movements. So it's an open problem. How do we design polytime algorithms for general Gaussians when the number of components is bounded by poly? And our algorithm is a first step towards this. So yeah, so what we get out of our work is a poly n time algorithm to recover parameters of a non-degenerate zero mean Gaussian mixture where the number of components is poly n, and we are given the constant order movements of the mixture exactly. Okay. So yeah, so certain things I should clarify. So the zero mean part is not too crucial. Our algorithm naturally generalizes to general mean Gaussians, and just that we haven't rigorously proved that it works, but yeah, it should most likely work out. And anyways, the zero mean Gaussian mixture thing is a representative case for this problem. Okay, so the main issue is that we need the moments exactly, right? And to get smoothed analysis, we need to make the algorithm noise resilient. That is, we need the algorithm to work if the moments are given approximately. So that's an excellent open question. And also to get smoothed analysis, we also need to analyze condition number of some random matrices which occur in the algorithm. So yeah, so the smoothed analysis of mixture of general Gaussians is an excellent open problem. To conclude, we have a meta framework to design learning algorithms from lower bounds. We reduced to this problem called vector space decomposition. And we also design a new lower bound method for depth flow circuits, which we call a fine projection of partials, which allows us to prove a tight lower bound and then design the average case learning algorithms. Yeah, so there's some upcoming work on some more average case learning. I'll quickly skip. And also we're working on making the algorithms noise resilient. So in terms of open problems, so going beyond tensor decomposition in learning probabilistic models. So tensor decomposition is a very special case of reconstruction or arithmetic circuit learning. And it's proven useful in so many applications in machine learning. Can we design applications for this more general arithmetic circuit learning? And yeah, we have more lower bounds for various other arithmetic circuit classes like multilinear formulas, regular formulas. Can we turn them into average case learning algorithms? And finally, making the algorithms noise resilient is very open, very interesting open problem. A concrete open problem is carrying out the smoothed analysis of general mixtures of questions. So thank you.